Hello, Lakers Nation. My name is Trevor Lane, senior writer for LakersNation.com, and this is the Lakers Nation news feed, breaking down all the latest Lakers news. Unfortunately, I have some bad news to delve into today. We've got, of course, the DeMarcus Cousins injury, which I'm sure you've heard about by now. DeMarcus Cousins tearing his ACL in his left knee, most likely season-ending. That's right, the Lakers season hasn't even started. We're still a few months away from the start of the season, and it looks like they've lost the guy who I thought was going to be their starting center. Absolutely brutal, crushing blow for the Lakers, and I know Lakers fans out there are feeling it right now, especially after what they just endured last season with injuries to Lonzo Ball, LeBron James, Brandon Ingram, Kyle Kuzma, Josh Hart, basically everyone, JaVale McGee, everyone was hurt. Had some sort of injury or sickness or whatever, and to now start this season off with it has so much promise, bringing in Anthony Davis and all these great pieces that Rob Pelinka put together, to lose DeMarcus Cousins already. It's a massive, massive blow to the Lakers, but we're not going to sit in a pity party for too long. Instead, what we're going to do today is we're going to start taking a look at some options for the Lakers. What can they do to replace DeMarcus Cousins? Going to dive into it in just a moment. But first, quick shout out to our sponsors, Uptime Energy Drink. So energy should feel. You can find them at 7-Eleven, GNC, and Amazon.com, and betonline.ag. All you have to do is head to betonline.ag, punch in the promo code CLNS50, and you get a 50% welcome bonus. Okay, so I went ahead and made up a list of a few players the Lakers could target. Now, here's the thing. I think this Lakers team needs another center. I think that much is very, very clear. I've seen a few people talking about, well, you know, Anthony Davis is just going to have to eat up some more minutes at center. Not happening. It's not. It's not going to happen. Look, Davis himself has said publicly several times over the last few weeks that he greatly prefers to play power forward. He'll play center a little bit if he has to, but he doesn't really want to. He would rather play power forward. And that makes a ton of sense. Look, for the Lakers' sake, they probably want him playing more minutes at power forward anyway, because they don't want the grind, the physical toll on Anthony Davis. And let's not forget, Davis is a free agent in 2020. You probably want to give the guy what he wants and let him play a role that he's comfortable in, rather than force him to do something that he's not, and then have him have that bitter taste in his mouth the entire season, and then head into free agency and maybe have wondering eyes. So I don't think the Lakers are just going to turn to Anthony Davis and say, sorry, now you have to play center with DeMarcus Cousins out. Instead, I think they're going to look for other options. Now, they did sign JaVale McGee, got him locked up on a one-year deal with another year on a player option, $4 million, and then a $4.2 million player option. Obviously, if they didn't do that, they'd be in big, big trouble at this point. DeMarcus Cousins only had a one-year $3.5 million deal. I thought he was going to be the steal of the summer. It would have been an incredible signing for them. Would have been a great fit, too, with his floor spacing. Instead, now you'd have to imagine that JaVale McGee is most likely the Lakers' starting center. He'll be an interesting fit alongside Anthony Davis. I think it works. I worry a little bit about the floor spacing, but McGee and LeBron did have pretty good chemistry last season. So I think ultimately it's going to work out. But you need a backup center. You can't just turn to Anthony Davis and tell him to play all those minutes at five. Kyle Kuzma's not going to do it. We saw that experiment last season. Did not work. Kuzma doesn't have the size to do it. Jared Dudley obviously isn't doing it. Nobody that the Lakers have brought in can really do that permanently. LeBron James, you can't ask him to play center permanently or anything like that. So they need to go find somebody else. Now, fortunately, the Lakers do have an open roster spot still. They didn't burn it on anybody. And I know they still need to back up small forward. So maybe they look at an Andre Iguodala later on down the line if he gets bought out from the Memphis Grizzlies. I think that's someone they're kind of holding out for right now. But they may need to go ahead and use that roster spot on a big for the time being. And then when they find out what's going on with DeMarcus Cousins, maybe eventually he gets waived if it's clear he's definitely not coming back this season. But I wouldn't close that door unless we know for sure that he's not coming back. It's unlikely he comes back this season. But again, until they know 100%, I don't think I'd be ready to close that door just yet. So maybe they could make a move waiving somebody like a guy on a minimum salary, like a Troy Daniels or somebody like that, in order to free a little bit more space for a wing later on if they decide to go ahead and burn their 15th and final roster spot on a big. Now, I went through and took a look at some of the bigs that are out there right now. And, well, it's slim pickings, as you would imagine. Free agency on the market in August, the middle of August, it's pretty barren. There's not a whole lot out there. So let me just, before I even start, throw this out there. There is no solution here. There's no quick fix. There is no one that's going to jump off the page and make you say, wow, that's it. Our problems are solved. We've found our replacement. That doesn't exist. Okay, it's not out there. And furthermore, the Lakers are going to have a tough time trading for anybody that could fill DeMarcus Cousins' role because they've burned so many of their assets to get Anthony Davis. So they really are in a tough spot. But that doesn't mean it's impossible. Because guess what? I'm here. I've got my GM shirt on. I am ready to roll. I'm going to start throwing out some names here. First, my honorable mentions, guys that they could look at, but I don't think they go there. Ryan Anderson, I think he's an interesting fit. Can't play center defensively. Can't play, well, just about anywhere defensively at this point. It's not his game, but he's a great shooter. And given that the Lakers were going to use DeMarcus Cousins to space the floor, maybe you could make the argument you look there. I don't think they do, but interesting idea. Salah Mejri, who is getting up there in years a little bit, but can't protect the rim. We saw him in limited minutes with the Dallas Mavericks. I think there's better options out there, but maybe. Marcin Gortat, wouldn't that be ironic? If the Clippers have Ivica Zubac and then the Lakers go and bring in Marcin Gortat, who was the center that the Clippers cut in order to bring in Ivica Zubac. By the way, how much worse does the Ivica Zubac trade feel now when the Lakers could have really used him at this point? But I don't think he's got the mobility at this point. He looked like he was really struggling last season, so I wouldn't go him. And you know what name's been thrown out there quite a bit? I even have a radio show that I was on today, threw this one out there. Carmelo Anthony. They said, does this mean that Carmelo Anthony gets picked up now by the Lakers? I don't think so. Okay, yes, you can say the Lakers need something. They need to bring in someone else, someone that with some firepower and all of that. And that makes a little bit of sense, but I think you need a like-for-like swap here. You need a big. The Lakers need a big. Carmelo Anthony doesn't give them a position of need at all. He's not a 3-and-D wing that can go and defend the league's best swingman, and he's certainly not a center. So I think the Lakers need those two things. Carmelo Anthony just doesn't really fit there, much as I'd like to see Carmelo get another shot somewhere. So here they are. The big three, players that I think that the Lakers should indeed look at, and I'm going to kick off this list with a guy who I like quite a bit, actually, and that is the Manimal, Kenneth Faried. Kenneth Faried, at one point, was one of the best up-and-coming young bigs in the league. I mean, he even played with Team USA. This is a guy who had a ton of energy, could fly up and down the floor. I mean, they called him the Manimal for a reason, super high motor, and did some really impressive stuff. But then the league kind of passed him by. We saw the NBA sort of evolve where bigs his size, he's only 6'8", needed to be able to do things off the bounce, make passes after attacking closeouts. They had to be able to shoot from outside, and he struggles in those areas. So Faried kind of fell by the wayside. In fact, the Denver Nuggets had a salary dump him last summer on the Brooklyn Nets, and then the Brooklyn Nets waived him in January, and it looked like that was going to be it. Looked like he was going to be done. I mean, look, he's 29 years old, and Kenneth Faried, it looked like his NBA career was all but over. And then he got picked up by the Houston Rockets. Clint Capella got injured, and next thing you know, Kenneth Faried started most of February for the Houston Rockets, put up really nice numbers. In fact, he put up 14.8 points and 9.6 boards on average in the month of February while starting for the Houston Rockets. And this is the reason why I bump him up on my list here. He actually shot 35% from three, his career high, 35% from three. Now, he only took 0.8 shots per game, so this is an extremely tiny sample size. But if the Lakers are convinced that Kenneth Faried is for real as being able to shoot from outside, even if he can just be respectable just a little bit, this is a guy who could really, really fit. Now, again, he's only 6'8", so he's not going to be a rim protector, not going to do any of those things that the Lakers need from him. So that's a little bit of negative, but he does have a little bit of switchability to him. He can step out on point guards a little bit, at least hedge better than some of the other guys on this list will be able to, because he is a bit quicker. He's also younger than anyone else that's going to be on this list at just 29 years old. I think he still has a little bit more in his tank than some of these other players. Again, not perfect by any means, but this is a guy who can battle on the boards, can provide a ton of energy, and if you're throwing him in for 10, 15 minutes a game behind JaVale McGee, and then Anthony Davis picks up the other, you know, few minutes here or there at center, you know what, there'd be worse rotations in the league, that's for sure. So Kenneth Faried is a guy who I think they should strongly consider looking at. Moving on to the next player on the list, I've got a guy who is a former Defensive Player of the Year, two-time All-Star, Joakim Noah. Joakim Noah was at one point one of the better centers in the NBA. His ability to hit the boards, his ability to rebound, and his ability to pass were all extremely, extremely high. And he was a star, basically, for the Chicago Bulls. And then things started to fall apart when he signed with the New York Knicks. He became one of the worst contracts in the NBA to the point where they eventually waived and stretched his contract. But as happens sometimes, we saw it with Fried, Noah found a new home with the Memphis Grizzlies, and it looked like it revitalized him, brought some new life back into his game, and we saw him starting to do some of the things that he had done back when he was with Chicago. We saw him starting to really battle on the boards. He was doing a great job there. His defense was good. In fact, with the Memphis Grizzlies last season, Joakim Noah was in the 70th percentile defensively per synergy. That is really good. He only played 16.5 minutes per game, so that's not a lot. 34 years old, this isn't a guy that you can count on to play a ton of minutes, but again, coming off the bench behind JaVale McGee, you could certainly do worse than a guy like Joakim Noah. It's an intriguing addition. He cannot shoot from outside at all. He can't stretch the floor. It's not like Fried, where you kind of wonder maybe he can stretch the floor a little bit every once in a while. Noah is not that guy. But for somebody to at least come in and play maybe kind of a Tyson Chandler-esque role like we saw with the Lakers last season, come in, set some hard screens, do some dirty work on the boards, and then occasionally get a putback here or there. That's about what you'd be expecting out of Joakim Noah, and he could be a fit in that regard. Now, he has had some issues with LeBron James in the past, but you know what? If LeBron James can play alongside Lance Stephenson, like he did last season, I'm not going to count out the idea that he could play next season alongside Joakim Noah. So maybe that's an option for them. Last one on the list. Let me just put this out there. Don't kill me. I'm going to say that. Don't come after me. I'm going to be ducking as I put this graphic up, but this one is, it's a sore subject. Dwight Howard. Dwight Howard is the next guy on this list. And I did everything I could to keep him off of here because I know how Lakers fans feel about Dwight Howard. Trust me. I get it. Dwight Howard was a Laker for one season, the 2012-2013 season. And then he left in free agency, left the Lakers high and dry. There were the stay Dwight billboards put up around Los Angeles. The Lakers looked terrible because they lost a free agent to the Houston Rockets and on and on and on. He clashed with Kobe while he was in L.A. Yeah, look, I get it. Lakers fans still have a bad taste in their mouth over what happened with Dwight Howard all those years ago. But in terms of upside, Dwight Howard might offer the most out of anybody that I've talked about so far today. And that's not underselling it because look, he is the definition of high risk, high reward. Last season with the Washington Wizards, he only played 9 games. He had a back issue early, couldn't get himself right. Of course, now he's been saying all the right things about how he feels great. He feels wonderful. He's got his body right, all of that. He says that just about every offseason though, how he's looking forward to a fresh start as he moves from team to team. But here's the intriguing thing. Dwight Howard, not last season, but the season before last with the Charlotte Hornets, averaged 16.6 points and 12.5 rebounds starting and played in 81 games that season. 81. So that means he only missed one game as a Charlotte Hornet. That is incredible for Dwight Howard. And if the Lakers have any sort of a sense that maybe that's still in there, that maybe he really is back to full health. He's not going to have a season like the one he had in Washington, but instead he's got another season in him like he had with the Charlotte Hornets. You have to look at him there because that upside is so high. He can be a monster on the board still. No, he's not the rim protector he used to be. It's not a no-fly zone around the basket like it was when he was with the Orlando Magic. This is a guy who relied on his athleticism for so long to carry him and never really developed the skills that he needed at the NBA level. But that doesn't mean he still can't do some good things out there on the floor. He's great on the boards. He can set some screens when he's motivated. And look, I get it. It's a major, major, major risk. But if the Lakers were somehow convinced that Dwight Howard is back, that he is fully healthy, and that he is willing to play whatever role the team is asking him to play, and I get it. Those are a lot of really big ifs. Maybe, just maybe, they should give a look at Dwight Howard. And look, I get it, guys. I can't even believe I'm saying that. But here we are. Like I said, the market is extremely thin, and you can't afford to close the door on anybody at this point, regardless of the past. And it would be interesting, certainly, to see how Lakers fans would respond to Dwight Howard after all these years and given what the history is. All right, that's going to about do it, guys. Let me know what you think. Fire off some comments. Who do you think the Lakers should go after? Do you agree with me that you should go after Kenneth Faried? Because I think he'd be number one on my list out of these guys. Or should they look somewhere else? Are you willing to forgive Dwight Howard at this point? Is he the guy that you go with? Do you throw Joakim Noah and LeBron James together and hope that they can figure out a way to make up? Or is there something that I'm forgetting about? Someone else that they could go after that you like better than I listed here? Go ahead, fire off some comments down below. Let me know. Interested to see what you guys think. Again, tough, tough day, Lakers fans. I'm right there with you. I'm feeling it. It's a brutal one, but you know what? We're going to get through it just like we always do. And hopefully Rob Pelinka and the Lakers will be able to find a replacement in the middle for DeMarcus Cousins that can at least keep the team intact and then keep them rolling moving forward here. Guys, for more on this story and everything else going on in the world of the Los Angeles Lakers, make sure you head over to LakersNation.com. And don't forget to follow us on social media at Lakers Nation on Facebook and Twitter, at Lakers Nation Official on Instagram. And of course, subscribe to the Lakers Nation YouTube channel for videos like this one and all the others that we have coming out soon. Till next time, guys, my name's Trevor Lane. You can follow me on Twitter at Trevor_Lane. See ya.